Today is the anniversary of Ramana Maharshi's Mahasamadhi. He dropped the body today. And what he always said was, our efforts should be to remove the blocks. Just remove the blocks that's blocking what's already present. Don't try to attain what's already present. Remove the blocks from it. We're blocking it. And that's our approach here. That's our approach. We don't worry about the results so much. We're not striving to be this or that. We're practicing, we're removing the blocks. And when you do that, automatically, what we really are, our true life, our true experiencing, what is true will dawn upon us. We don't have to do anything other than to remove the blocks. So our focus is always on this effort to remove the blocks, to relinquish the vows that we are making, to deny reality. We're vowing to deny reality. We need to reverse and relinquish those vows that we have made, very deep subconscious vows that are controlling our experiencing right now, which is the experiencing of trying to find a way to do the impossible. So our lives feel very kind of oddly unsuitable. Was driving along this morning, and I realized how I feel so tiny, like this world is so tiny. I'm so tiny. The world is so tiny. It's like, wow, I need something vaster, much, much vaster. This doesn't feel right to feel so small and tiny. It's the first time I've ever felt that. Really interesting. It's probably been there all along. I'm just aware of it now. And so I want something really, really big. Really vast. The feeling of feeling so small and tidy is not a great feeling, is it? Actually, it's not at all. Really, I feel like this world is just like this little dot of sand or something. It's like, what's going on here? So we had to take care of some essential business today out in California. The hospitals here are nearly empty because all elective surgeries have been canceled. People aren't going in for just this and that, simple little things, right? And the surge never happened here in California. So the hospitals are about 30% full. They take pictures of them. It's like a ghost town in there, the hospitals. Wow. But we're supposed to, in the U.S., supposed to be reaching the peak this week. So we're going this week, supposed to be the big surge. A lot of us are, you know, scratching our heads, of course. I mean, there's obviously something big going on. We feel something really big's going on, but it's not necessarily the coronavirus that's the big going on. There's other stuff behind that, isn't there? For sure. But we're still, certainly, there's a feeling of people are uneasy. And they're telling us now, you know, the economy will be bad for, you know, another 18, what's it, a year and a half or 18 months or something. And, you know, it's like, okay, all right. Doesn't feel like the future is necessarily so settled. It feels like turmoil. And there certainly will be turmoil. But we're interested in removing the blocks so that we can feel a feeling that's suitable for us. We want to feel like this is suitable. I feel really suited to this. And what is that? It's reality. So in the experience of direct experience of reality, there's this feeling of pure, perfect suitability. Pure, perfect suitability. You just fit. You say, I fit here. I totally fit into this. Okay, get that. I totally fit into this. Totally. Can you imagine what that feels like? It feels, you say, yeah. That's it. I totally fit into this. Whereas in this world, I feel like I don't fit at all. I'm just this tiny little bug on this tiny little world, drifting in this dark space. I said, this doesn't feel suitable. I don't feel like I fit in here. Don't fit in here. So that, you know, that's a good awareness. I just don't feel like I fit in here. Don't try to force it. Try to remove the blocks to experiencing reality where we do fit in. We fit in perfectly. And it's a shock. We just say, oh my gosh, I thought I was such a misfit in this world. We feel like misfits here, right? And then in reality, I feel like I fit perfectly. And that's what we love. We love that feeling of fitting in perfectly. We love it. intrinsically so. Quite a surprise. I just said, hey, this is what I really want. Yes, like that. And then we find ourselves going back to this feeling, misfit life here, the misfit life in Corona land. Yeah. So this morning I asked for a practice and it was given. Very difficult practice. And it's caused me, you know, stress and strain. Yeah, it's powerful, but difficult, difficult. There is no universe to opt out of. Wow. Universe is anomaly, an anomaly as well. There is no universe to opt out of. Wow. Universe is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no universe to opt out of. Wow. Universe is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no world to opt out of. Wow. World is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no world to opt out of. Wow. World is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no life to opt out of. Wow. Life is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no life to opt out of. Wow. Life is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no time to opt out of. Wow. Time is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no time to opt out of. Wow. Time is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Okay, so, yeah, that's really, really cracking down on it all. And we do need to crack down. Today was the beginning of really cracking down on Zone 4. You know, the stuff that's going on in the world, I say it's a coup d'etat in this world. It's a global takeover by scientific materialists, so to speak. A certain ideology is now seizing control of this world, and you can feel it. Everybody feels it. Some are saying, yeah, yeah, yeah. A lot of people are saying, whoa, you know, what's going on here? It's a coup d'etat. It is a coup d'etat, and it is a seizing control of this planet, the ideology of this planet, by scientific materialism. And all that they promise us, you know, better pills, you know. But they certainly don't know how to remove the blocks to what we really are. They're ignorant of this. They're ignoramuses. They've specialized in scientific materialism, and they've completely ignored the spiritual technology necessary to remove these blocks to an awareness of what we really are. So there's, like I said, I say we're going back to another Stone Age, actually. It's a psychological Stone Age. We're going into the psychological Stone Age. Very worrisome for me, very worrisome. And I'm saying, like, wow, get me out of here. I had a dream last night, and my friend said, get your golf bag. We're going to Hawaii. We're going to Hawaii. Grab your golf bag, you know, and get ready because we're going to Hawaii. I was like, what? What are you talking about? Yeah. No, seriously. They said, seriously. This is serious. We're going to Hawaii. Now, Hawaii represents like paradise, doesn't it? It represents this feeling like of suitability. Interesting, isn't it? So someone was telling me very emphatically in this dream, we're going to this the land of suitability, to this feeling of suitability. I said, okay, yeah, I'm ready to go. And I was watching this, saw this article on the Masters Golf Tournament, which is really the most famous golf tournament in the world. And it's, of course, been postponed this year. And people were talking about it. You know, if you were just an amateur and you tried to play this course under tournament conditions, what would you shoot? And I'm like, everyone's thinking like, huh, you know, would it be under 100 or over 100? And I was thinking like, wow, it'd be kind of scary. But in practicing, I practice my golf swing every day just to stay limber and flexible. It's just an exercise I do. But my swing's really good right now. Really, really, really good. And I said, you know what? I'm ready for the Masters. I can do this. Doesn't scare me, actually. Doesn't really scare me. So I can go out there and play. So I said, let's do this. Let's do it. I'm ready to go. So pretty interesting. That before I was afraid, but what it was I just know how to take my stance, get the right ball position. I know exactly what I'm doing with my swing, and so I just know exactly what to do. Yeah, and just the results, they'll take care of themselves. I'm not worried about results at all. Not even thinking about results. Isn't that interesting? And it's the same way here. I'm not even really thinking about results. I'm thinking about practicing, doing the practice properly. And I know this is removing the troubles. If you swing the golf club properly, the ball's going to go. You don't have to worry about it. It's going to go. So if you do the right practicing, the results are going to come. The results are going to come. So there is no universe to opt out of. Wow. Universe is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no world to opt out of. Wow. World is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no life to opt out of. Wow. Life is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. There is no time to opt out of. Wow. Time is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Now, this is a very sophisticated, difficult practice. But I'm able to do it. The purpose of this is to crack down on zone four. We're cracking down on these knuckleheads. These ignoramuses who are so overreaching in terms of scientific materialism, they've ignored what the true technology we need. They've ignored it. To relinquish our death vows. Okay, our vulnerability vows. We vow to be vulnerable. We vow to be to die. We vow to ignore reality. We vow to try to learn to love this unsuitability. We have these inner vows, and there's this scientific technology of this practicing of how to reverse and relinquish those vows. And the cabal that's taking over this planet. They're ignoramuses in this, really, very severely so, very severely so. And they say, "Don't worry, you know, we'll give you the right drugs or spiritual experiences. You know, we'll just take the right drugs, and you'll be able to figure it out from those drugs. You know, whenever." No, you won't be able to. So we're having to crack down. Zone five is now cracking down on zone four, very hard, but in a gentle way, that maintains everyone's dignity. Okay, gentle, forgiving, dignity, but nevertheless really cracking down on zone four. It's now begun. So zone four, they were warned, don't do it. They did it, okay? They did their blitzkrieg. They've started their blitzkrieg. That's just the beginning. The corona thing is just the beginning, okay? Then the lockdown came from corona. First corona, then lockdown, now economic devastation, okay? Step by step by step by step. So they decided to start it, you know. So now we have to respond and to crack down on zone four. Really crack down hard on them. So this type of practicing actually cracks down really hard on zone four. So there is no universe to opt out of. Wow. The universe is anomaly. Universe is anomaly. And anomaly is wow. Just no universe to opt out of. Wow. Just no universe to opt out of wow. Universe is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no universe to opt out of wow. Universe is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no world to opt out of wow. World is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no world to opt out of wow. World is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no life to opt out of wow. Life is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no life to opt out of. Just no life to opt out of wow. Life is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no time to opt out of wow. Time is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no time to opt out of wow. Time is an anomaly and anomaly is wow. Okay. So this is now zone four people, zone four mentality perspective will not understand what we're talking about here at all. You'll say you're crazy. But, well, we understand it very clearly, and this is cracking down hard on zone four perspective, that's to say the least. They insist that indeed there is a universe, indeed there is a world, indeed there is a life, and indeed there is time, and that is our home. Universe, world, body, time is our home. It is not our home at all. Actually, there is none of that. That's just like a mirage. It's an illusion, dreamlike mirage, universe, world, life, time. None of that's real. None of it is real at all. And actually, it tells us absolutely nothing about our real experiencing, our true home, our true life, our true experiencing. There's no similarity. It tells us nothing about it. Nothing about it. No commonality. No commonality between this a universe, world, life, time, dream, and reality. There's no commonality at all. But fortunately for us, that's not a problem, because when we experience reality, we say, oh, this is perfectly suitable for me. Wow, no trouble at all. And that's a shock. It is no trouble at all for us. We feel like a duck taken to water. Ah, this is what I've been missing. This is perfect. I'm totally suitable for me. Without us having to do anything to make it suitable, it's intrinsically suitable for us. How about that? How great is that? Intrinsically, perfectly suitable for us. Wow. So, incredible viewership here. So I'm continuing to work on this. Probably won't go as long, as long on this video, because it's tiring. It's tiring. Did about 6 hours in the last 2 days of intense sharing here. Tired. You know, that's fatiguing. It's like running a marathon, back-to-back marathons or something like that. But if the time, you know, is now to really give it all we got. We've got to crack down hard on Zone 4. Because just like World War II, the Nazi blitzkrieg, okay? Up until that time, there was a lot of, you know, saying, hey, don't do it. You know, we're still negotiating. We can come up, you know, don't do it. And they said, oh, don't worry, we won't, you know. And then, boom, they did it. Caught the Allies by surprise. They said, holy cow, we didn't think they would do that. Well, they did. And at that point, you know, the gloves came off. The gloves came off. Well, they needed to at that point, right? And said, okay, we got to crack down hard on this. And so we're at the point where we have to crack down really hard on Zone 4 and what they're up to. And we are doing that. We are doing that. So we've begun to do this. So just no opt out of the universe. Wow, there's no universe to opt out of. Wow, okay. So just no universe to opt out of. Wow, just no world to opt out of. Wow, just no body to opt out of. Wow, just no time to opt out of. Wow, just no universe to opt out of. Wow, just no world to opt out of. Wow, just no body to opt out of. Wow, just no time to opt out of. Wow. So you might be able to feel like you said, wow, this is really amazing. I mean, this is, whew, you know, really cracking down on a certain perspective, isn't it? It certainly is. And I had trouble again this morning. I asked Coach Needham. I said, Coach Needham, I was feeling pretty lousy. And I said, okay, I'm here to be coached up. You give me the practice. And this is the practice that was given. It started out with just no universe to opt out. Wow. And I had trouble doing it. I had trouble. I said, this is difficult. But I said, I got to do it. And then as I was doing it, I realized this is really, it's cracking down on Zone 4 time, isn't it? This is go time. And, you know, this is pushback, big pushback here. And that's part of my job is to provide some of this pushback. You know, I'm just kind of like a foot soldier in this, you know, conflict. It's a war. It's World War III, actually, is what's going on. It's a psychological war. World War III is a psychological war more than anything. It could turn into a physical one too. That's possible. It could be all sorts of physical turmoil, but mostly it's a battle for your attention. Okay, it's a battle for your attention. It's a psychological war. So my job is to push back hard, but in a gentle way, kind and gentle way, but never nonetheless very, very strong, hard, you know, pushback on this. So just saying, you know, there is no universe to opt out of. Wow. Just no universe to opt out of. Wow. Just no world to opt out of. Wow. Just no body to opt out of. Wow. Just no time to opt out of. Wow. Universe is anomaly and anomaly is wow. World is anomaly and anomaly, anomaly is wow. Body is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Life is anomaly as well, but body and time is anomaly and anomaly as well. So just no life to opt out of. Wow. Because, yeah, just no body. Which was better? Just no body to opt out of. Wow. Just no universe to opt out of. Wow. Just no world to opt out of. Wow. Just no body to opt out of. Wow. Just no time to opt out of. Wow. You could use body. Maybe that's better than life. Just know universe to opt out of wow. Just know world to opt out of wow. Just know body to opt out of wow. Just know time to opt out of wow. Universe is anomaly and anomaly is wow. World is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Body is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Time is anomaly and anomaly is wow. So you could see that Coach Nilam has coached me up well, you know, and the other coaches I've had. To be able to put this out there, you know, very intensely and clearly like this is not easy. It is not easy, but that's the training. I was trained to be able to do this. So this morning I had to show I was willing to assume my role in this crackdown on zone four. And it's just like, you know, okay, it's go time. You got to do this. And I said, okay, wow, okay. And I've been able to do it, but I'm stressful and tiring, but as expected, you know, you would expect that. So just know universe to opt out of wow. Universe is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just know world to opt out of wow. World is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just know body to opt out of wow. Body is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just know time to opt out of wow. Time is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Now, it's been experienced over and over again that when we really focus on time and reverse this vow of time, to believe in time, this seems to have the greatest effect of anything. It really does. And Jesus tells us this. He says, your greatest illusion, your greatest false vow is time. And he says, that's the toughest one. Time is the toughest one. But when you can really focus on time and reverse that vow, that is going to have the greatest positive effect. And I've certainly experienced that. The times when I've been able to push back against this time vow, that's when experiences of reality have just been there. Just, there it is. What did I do? I reversed my vow of time into a vow of forgiveness, and there's reality. It's just there. It's like, wow. Yeah. So time is really the most important vow to push back on, actually. The most important one. It's the glue that holds all our vows together. So when we really relinquish time, all our vows disappear. They all subside just like that. And I've experienced this. I push back on time in the right way, and the whole complex of false vows just subsided altogether, just like that. It's like they've got gone, all of them. So again, time is the glue, our vow of time. And time means just that we're waiting for all these vows to be effective. So if you stop waiting for them to be effective, you know, you just say, oh, they're not effective at all. Gone. It's amazing what focusing on time will accomplish, but it's often not easy to do it because you realize this is the glue that holds my whole false vow system in place. My entire false vow system, my entire feudal vow system is being held in place by my vow of time. No question about that. So, but there that, you know, when we do get to it, we make massive headway that way, massive headway. So we're including this in this practice. That is very powerful, strong practice when you can include time in a practice like this. So just know universe to opt out of wow. Universe is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just know world to opt out of wow. World is anomaly and world and anomaly is wow. Just know body to opt out of wow. Body is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just know time to opt out of wow. Time is anomaly and anomaly is wow. So sometimes it's scary to practice on time directly. As soon as I turn my attention to time, I start getting the jitters. I realize, oh wow, this you are getting to the very glue that holds all our whole feudal vow system together. It gets a little nervous. But if we can work time into our practices, like that's just a quarter, you know, 1/4 of our practicing, kind of slipping it in there at the end, it's not quite as scary. It's not quite as scary. But you will find you have tremendous resistance to really practicing to reverse time vow properly. It feels like, wow, this might be too big. You know, this is really too big. Like, whoa, let me back off a little bit. You know, that happens. I have a difficult time getting to it. I know if I get to it, I'll have you know, the results will be there, but it's easier said than done. We kind of just feel like sluggish if we try to do too much time practice. We'll feel this kind of like just disinterest, like, I don't really feel like practicing at all. So don't try to force it. Don't try to force it. Don't take drugs to try and force it. Don't take caffeine or any type of, you know, anything. Don't take anything to try and force it. You're practicing. That'll cause you big problems. If you try to force your practicing with time, the backlash will be more than you can handle. Okay. And really, you may have success, but you force the issue and you're not psychologically ready. You don't know how to handle, maintain your poise with that much success in a forced scenario. And you're going to then get what's called stuck in one of these pitfalls of either spiritual idealism, nihilism, depression, or quantification fixation. So you may become extremely fixated on trying to explain reality in terms of, you know, spiritual idealism. That's a fixation because you tried to force this reversal of time vow in a forceful way that you're psychologically, you were not ready for that and you were not able to maintain your poise. And then you overcompensate by trying to explain to everybody about, you know, I know exactly what spirituality, that I am this and light and all. You start becoming real expository in terms of trying to explain theory of exactly how reality is. When in fact, what are you not doing? You're not practicing effectively to remove the blocks. All right, so you hear there's all sorts of people like that, and they're taking drugs to force the issue. You come across these people all the time, and they make you kind of feel inferior because they sound like, you know, so knowledgeable about exactly how reality, you know, works, the light and the you know, the love and the I am and all this kind of stuff. But that's compensation, overcompensating for not actually, you know, they've overcompensating for trying to force the issue and not being able to maintain their poise in the face of actually experiencing reality right now without any resistance at all, actually. Overcompensation for that. So don't try to force your practicing. Often by practicing, like when I'm kind of tired, I say, okay, well, let me just see if I could do some. Let me give my best. But never do I take any sort of coffee or any sort of drug or stimulant or do anything to help myself. Maybe I'll take, you know, drink a smoothie or something, a protein smoothie, whatever. It doesn't help that much, really, nothing. But there's no forcing it. I'm not doing anything to try to force it except just my willingness to say, okay, let's see if I've got anything in the tank here. And like now, I'm tired, but let's just see if I got something in the tank that can help out. So that's really, really, really important. Extremely important. Never try to use means to force results in what we're doing. This will actually stall you out very badly. So you have to be patient with your results. They will show up when you're ready for them. They'll show up when you're ready for them. When you've done enough, you know, when you're psychologically ready for them, the results will show up and you'll just feel like, oh, okay. Okay, so that's it. Okay. Like, no problem. Yeah. Oh, okay, this is it. Okay, this is like perfect. This perfect suitability. Okay. Let me just pay attention to this and just enjoy this. I feel, yeah. And you'll feel calm. You'll feel balanced. You'll feel poised. No problem at all. And then you'll come out when you finally it's starting to get some jitters deep down. You'll come out of it smoothly. You'll say, okay, wow, that was wow, and you just feel like, okay, this did not unhinge me, and don't need to overcompensate. Therefore, and so you'll stay smooth, and then you'll continue practicing the next day or a little while, and you'll just stay smooth. Your momentum will remain. Be with you. You'll still maintain the same, you know, momentum, if not more so. The whole thing is safe and smooth. Safe and smooth. That's what we do here. Safe and smooth. Although it is a stressful. You know, I'm feeling it. But I don't say, wow, I got to force it. So let me drink a bunch of coffee and and try to force the issue, that's disaster. That's disaster. I know that from personal experience. I speak from experience. That's disaster. You will end up in a weird place. You say, how did I end up here? I can't believe I ended up here. Can't believe it. And then, you know, it's just like, holy cow. And fortunately, it's amazing. You know, you somehow grace helps you out. The grace of God helps you out. And for me, coffee caused the peristalsis, which moves all the food through your intestines. It caused that all to stop. And nothing would move through my system. Nothing would move through my system. I couldn't eat. I couldn't get anything to go through my system. It just stayed sitting in my system. First one time for a month, and I just had to drink fluids for a month. It happened like about four times, I think. Just about killed me each time. And after that, I said, okay, no more. This, I can't do it anymore. Cannot have any caffeine whatsoever. Cannot have any caffeine whatsoever. Unless it's an extreme emergency, like driving, and I'm about ready to just absolutely fall asleep. Then I have an emergency, it's Coca-Cola or something. I'll drink that to stay awake. But other than that, absolutely no caffeine. It's deadly. You know, the stuff can be very deadly. Now, why that happened, I don't know, but it happened. It's scary. When your peristalsis stops and your whole insides, the things just stop and nothing moves. You try to eat, your stomach's full, your stomach doesn't empty. Nothing empties. Nothing empties. Just sits there. So that, you know, that got my attention. I said, I better stop this. And it got me in a lot of trouble. Caffeine got me in a ton of trouble. Really caused me to act in ways I wouldn't have acted otherwise at all. It's a very strong drug, actually, believe it or not. Extremely strong, but it's very subtle and clever. It works so well with our ego that we don't think it's so strong. It is extremely strong, and it'll bring you into a place that you just say, you know, I can't believe I'm in this situation. It's unbelievable. That's just what drugs do. Eventually, you get to a place where you feel, this is so unbelievably wrong and bad, and how in the world did I get here? And well, overcompensation. Overcompensation. That's the great monster, really. Overcompensation is what we have to avoid like the plague. It's a million times worse than corona. Right? A million times worse. Overcompensation is, that's what ruins our lives. So here we're really careful to avoid that trap of overcompensation. Really careful. You know, safe, steady, middle pathing. Never try to force the issue. Never try to force the issue. And it seems like maybe we're going slower. We're going in a safe, fast, brisk momentum way and avoiding stalling out and then overcompensating for our stall out. And that's when we get into severe trouble. And on drugs, it's unavoidable that you stall out. It's unavoidable that you overcompensate. All of that's unavoidable. And the people who get the most in the most trouble are the smartest people who think they're so smart that they are going to be able to figure out a way to avoid the stall out and the overcompensation of using drugs. They just haven't quite got it yet. So they keep taking drugs, and you ask them, and you see them, they're so messed up. Their situation psychologically is so messed up, and yet they're certain that today they're going to figure out the way to deal, to use these drugs properly so they don't stall out and don't overcompensate. They're always certain that today's the day, it's not going to be a problem for me anymore. I said, well, what about, if you're so smart, what about the last, you know, 5 years where you've just been spiraling down, and you know, what do you think, you're gonna figure it out today? You're like a million times smarter today than you were yesterday? Now they say, no, I'm really desperate though, so I think I'll be really smart today. No, there is this. If you're really smart, you would stop trying to force the issue and stop taking drugs. If you're really smart. So maybe that's the problem. They're saying, gee, I'm not as smart as I thought I was. Nobody's smart enough to take drugs. No one. I've never met anyone who is smart enough to take drugs. There's so many who think they are. So many think they are, and there's some that think they really did it. No, they didn't. But we were, you know, grew up these heroes that they figured out a way to use drugs properly. It didn't bother them. They're so smart. We can be that smart. They didn't really get there. Not really. They may have stopped and then gotten back centered again. And eventually maybe they got there. But it wasn't because of the drugs. Okay? It wasn't because of the drugs. But to be heroes to the, you know, to the revolution, maybe they said, oh yeah, you know, that's a good way, and people love to hear that. But here, absolutely not. It's a certainty. Nobody's smart enough to force the issue with these vows that we have, subconscious vows. Nobody's smart enough to find a way around forcing the issue without stalling out and overcompensating. No one. That's why the greatest teachers say no. You can't do it. I can't do it. You can't do it. Nobody can do that. It's a certainty that you will stall out and overcompensate. It's a certainty. Even if it means to glorify stalling out. Okay. That's also stalling out, you know. That's also overcompensating. It really is. So now there are some people who are just so used to like coffee that it doesn't seem to affect them at all, hardly. It should, you know, if they don't take it, they get a severe headache or something. So they've developed such a tolerance for it, it doesn't seem to do anything for them. So in those cases, they should be very careful not to take any more than their just normal cup of coffee in the day or something, or whatever they're doing, just a normal amount. Don't ever try to force your practicing. Okay, that just keep that in mind. Don't ever try to force your practicing in any way. In any way, sex, drugs, rock and roll, in no way try to force your practicing, because you're dealing with the glue that holds your entire vow system together. Time, for instance. And it indeed, if you drop time, your entire vow system will subside into the absolute smoothness. And you have to be psychologically mature enough to allow that to happen in the right way, so it doesn't stall you out some point down the road. Maybe not right away. So I've noticed that in these really huge breakthroughs, that the shock is delayed. I have a friend who's a fire commander. And he tells me that shock, and the firemen are very aware of shock in injuries and fires and, you know, terrible shocking situations. They say it could be delayed up to a day, you know, or pushed back quite a bit, actually. Quite a bit. But when it hits, boy, does it hit hard. So when you have these breakthroughs, if you're mature and you approached it properly, the shock is delayed. And maybe the next day or the day after, you begin to feel like a little bit, you know, unnerved like that. But you're aware of that. You expect it. You know how to keep your poise. You know how to deal with it. And you're able to keep your momentum going. It doesn't become a stall out scenario for you. Whereas if you are not mature, you try to force it with drugs, you may have a big breakthrough. It seems that way. Down, and you think, oh, see, no problem. A couple days later, delayed shock, you may get hit with some extreme reaction where you think like you're going crazy or something, or you're like the stupidest person in the world, or something that just overwhelms your psyche. And then what do you do when that happens? You go back to more drugs, right? I say, oh, if I only had that experience I had before, I wouldn't have this. No, you're having this because you weren't ready for that experience, right? You get that? You're having this terrible, overwhelming shock because you weren't psychologically ready for this experience. You tried to force it in some way, and now you're experiencing that it doesn't work properly. It's bad, and the smarter you are, the more you think you can get away with it. They figure out like there's a way around that. It must be no. So it takes a while for us to wise up and say, "Hey, I may be really smart, but there is a limit to my smartness." We're dealing with dynamics here that are beyond smartness. Okay, what we're dealing with here requires something other than smartness. It requires dedication, perseverance, patience, humility, right technique, right encouragement, right reinforcement, right repetition. There's so many aspects that are required. A psychological maturity, a real strong maturity is required. A lot of hindsight, a lot of successful practicing, a lot of confidence of how to get through, you know, little breakthroughs. I may have had thousands and thousands of little breakthroughs. Each single one helped me understand how to maintain momentum when you have breakthroughs. So all of that experience, maturity, all that stuff enables you to, you know, go through the bigger breakthroughs. So if you try to force it with drugs, you're just being, you know, you're trying to be a rock star and you're not ready to be a rock star. And you know what happens to those who are not ready to be rock stars. Okay, yeah, they crash and burn. And that's no fun at all. That's not being a rock star, okay? No, it is not. But, you know, we have to get to these issues. Time is the glue that holds all our vows together, our absurdist, futile, useless, aimless, meaningless vows of trying to circumvent impossibility. All of that is held together by time. Yes. Hydrate time. Hopefully everyone is staying well. Just no universe to opt out of wow. Just no world to opt out of wow. Just no body to opt out of wow. Just no time to opt out of wow. So we gave three key type of vows. We're vowing to believe in a universe, vowing to believe in a world, vowing to believe in a body, that all of this is happening to us. A universe is happening to us. A world is happening to us. A body is happening to us. And then the glue that holds all those vows, vowing to believe in time, that it will get better, it will be successful, it will happen to us, that we will succeed ultimately. Time. Accumulation of success, you know, we're getting there. So eventually you will have experience with time where you're able to release it. It, you know, how to do that, I can't, it's difficult to explain it, but it, somehow you will do it just momentarily, and then you'll realize, wow, I just did something really amazing, you know. It's just like all my troubles just vanished. One insight settled it all. And that one insight that settled it all was you dropped your time vow. And without your time vow, all their vows have no foundation. Okay, so one insight does settle it all. One reversal does settle it all. Reverse our vow of time and everything else goes with it. Everything else goes with it. That's why we're scared to do it. Yeah, I'd love to do it right now. Maybe I will. I keep getting close, you know, knocking on the door. And if everything subsides, it's because I got to the time, reverse the time, time vow. But again, don't be in a hurry to be a rock star. Okay, that'll really mess you up bad. It's okay to not be a rock star. Okay, yeah, when you're ready to be a rock star, you will be. But it's perfectly, wonderfully fine to be a rock star in training. Okay, a rock star in training. Don't be in too much. Don't ever force it, because that'll just set you back badly. And then you'll try to force it even more. You say, oh my God, I want to be a rock star so bad, and I've got set back real bad. And now how can I catch up? Oh, okay, let me force things even more. And it gets worse and worse and worse. That is never the way. So, yeah, just be a spiritual rock star in training. In training. And if it takes you this life, that's fast. That's very fast. That's fine. If you get there some point in this life, that's tremendous. That's tremendous. And you get there by reversing the vow of time and maintaining that reversal. I would say there is no time to opt out of what? Just no time to opt out of wow. Just no time to opt out of wow. Time is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Time is just an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Time is just anomaly, and anomaly is wow. And you have to keep from going back to believing in time. As soon as you believe in time, those other vows start, you give them a foundation, and they come back also. But when we can keep time, the vow of time reversed, and forgive ourselves and reverse that vow, and continuously, none of the other vows are going to come back. They can't. They can't come back. There's no glue. There's no foundation for them. No foundation for them. Yeah. We could use some spiritual rock stars. You know? There's no question about it. There's no question about it. But you can't force it. You can't force it. So just because we have this, you know, catastrophe in the world basically going on, that doesn't mean you should force it. I'm not forcing it. I'm trying as best I can, but don't not try to use any sort of means to actually force it. You know, just being diligent and willing to but not no means to force the issue at all. So if it doesn't happen, it doesn't happen. I just have to keep working at it. That's all. And it has to be that way. Even though the world is screaming and crying out, you know, help, 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 help. You know, if you don't reverse the vow of time and keep it reversed, then you're not going to be able to help out in a real strong way. You're not going to be a spiritual rock star. It's not possible. It's not possible. That has to happen. Has to happen in order for you to be a very strong, you know, help for people, enough that people will really feel like, you know what, I can settle down. You know, there's something really suitable here, right? Yeah. So that's a fact. That's a fact. As long as we're still holding on to our vow of time, our effectiveness is going to be, you know, pretty mediocre. It's pretty mediocre. You know, a little bit of effectiveness, a little bit of helpfulness, yeah. But not, you know, not rock star quality at all. At all. No, we're like playing at the high school gym, not even that, garage band. We're a good garage band, you know, that kind of thing. But not even maybe a good garage band, but decent garage band. Maybe we're a decent garage band. I was in garage bands, but we were never good. We're too stupid to be good, you know. Nobody took charge and structured it, okay? Because that's the problem. No, nobody was willing, had the vision to structure it, thank goodness, because then maybe we'd have gotten into the music scene too much, too successful in it. But, you know, you need to structure it and say, hey, you know, here's some songs. We're going to learn these songs. This is how long the song is. This is the intro. This is the first verse. This is the chorus. This is the second verse. This is the bridge. This is going back to the chorus for the third time. And then this is the third verse. And then this is the outro of the song. And the song is going to last about 4 minutes. Okay, it's going to be done in the key of C. Okay, we're going to have the volume on each instrument is going to be this, okay, this. The vocals are going to have this type of volume on it, and we're going to rehearse this, 10 times rehearsal through this song, and we're going to tweak everything so we really get it smooth. That never happened in our garage bands. That never happened. You're doing the lead vocals. Okay, this is the harmony vocals. You got the high part of the harmony vocals. You got the middle part. You got the lower part. Okay, this is when the harmony comes in. And this is the balance in your voices. That never, ever happened in a garage band. Thankfully, because then we would have started sounding like the Beach Boys or something. I mean, I was good enough to be able to do that, except I never, somehow I was blocked from structuring it. which was great. Otherwise, I would have gotten in terrible trouble, sidetracked, because people would say, oh my gosh, you know, you got so much talent, you know, and it would have led to like some sort of middling musical career or something, which was not my destiny. But looking back, you know, a lot of times kids don't even think about that. But the ones that do, like Brian Wilson, they did think about that. And so, okay, we're going to structure this whole thing, this exactly, structure it all. We're going to practice the structure within the structure. And we're going to get a set list. Which songs, you know, to start out, you know, slow, you know, do we start out fast songs and slow songs, tempo, you know, all this kind of stuff. What do the kids like to dance to, all these things. Structuring all that out ahead of time. Knowing exactly, you know, what they're about. And then if you do that as when you're young, you know, you would ask, people would say, wow, this band's really polished. I mean, they're good. They're good. It doesn't take that much to be really good when you're young, you're right, in a garage band, because most of the kids don't think it through that clearly. And but the ones that do, you know, everyone says they're fabulous, and they say, oh, I'm not that great. I'm just thinking it through and structuring it. So here we're thinking through our practicing and structuring it to a certain extent. Maybe I'll do some, you know, to a greater extent, because then you actually become very proficient and talented at what you're practicing, and able to practice it in a way that you know you're good at practicing. You're pretty good at practicing. You're way better than most. Most people in this world are clueless about practicing. They're like 16-year-olds with a garage band, you know, just like making as much noise as they can. All right. So they just do not know how to structure. I mean, we have five steps here. We know how to structure it in five steps. And we also have the calming down of just counting to five. For instance, the counting to five. One, two, three, four, five. Like that. We have the forgiveness focus on, I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of trying to opt out of what doesn't exist. Wow. Trying to opt out of what doesn't exist. Wow. There is no universe to opt out of. I'm trying to opt out of a universe. To opt out of something, you first have to have that something. So if you're saying, I'm trying to opt out of the universe, you first have to believe there is a universe. If you're trying to say, I'm trying to opt out of time, you have to first believe that there's something real called time that I then have to opt out of. But there is no time to opt out of. There is no universe to opt out of, no world to opt out of, and no body to opt out of, actually. So I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of trying to opt out of anything. Wow. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of trying to opt out of anything. Wow. And you could use time. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of trying to opt out of time. Wow. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of trying to opt out of time. Wow. And then this is, remind yourself, there isn't actually any time at all other than my attempt to believe, to overcome it, or to opt out of it. That then holds my belief that it's there. But if I say, no, there is no time to opt out of wow. Time is an anomaly, and anomaly is wow. This reverses our vow to believe in that in time, and prevents us from reinforcing this belief by trying to figure a way to opt out of it. We reverse the vow. We don't opt out of time. We reverse the vow of believing in time. Okay, so we say just no time to opt out. Wow, there's no time there to opt out. That's reversing the vow of believing in time. Very, very sophisticated, very effective practice. Very effective practice. So that's advanced practicing. The forgiveness practice is helps really center us. Theory, that's the second step, helps us understand why we're doing this, and then blocking panic through using the wow term to block all elaboration. Whenever there's something that could lead to elaboration, we define it as wow. We use just a one term to say, I know this is wow. My results are wow. My practice is wow. Time is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. Universe is anomaly, and anomaly is wow. We just give this one term to it. Blocks all elaboration, all searching, all questioning, all thinking, all struggling. We said, I already got it. It's wow. That's The key, that's the first foundational step to success is this practice. So, and then the fifth step is direct experiencing. So, I may likely put a little more structure on what we're doing. So we're not just a ragged garage band. Been there, done that. That doesn't really work properly. You have to have somebody take charge. The problem with our garage bands was like, we were all talented musicians, but nobody was willing to say, okay, you know, you need to take charge, okay? Because otherwise, everyone's off in their own world, you know, chaos. No one was being humble enough to say, okay, you know, you're in charge. You decide. You pick the songs. I mean, you have to be. Someone has to be in charge. Unless you're really mature, like the Beatles, it was kind of Lennon, McCartney were pretty much in charge. There's a lot of tension there actually, and George Harrison was kind of in the background. Get a little bit, one song per album, he'd get a song, and then Ringo was just, you know, I'm just back here chilling with the drums, okay, but you know, you need someone who's in charge, and of course George Martin, the producer, was very much in charge. You need someone who's in charge. To say, okay, this is what we're doing here. So there's not chaos, not garage band chaos. It's same thing as spiritual focus here, our focus of reversing our vows. If there's nobody in charge, no one in charge, the whole thing falls apart. It's like a garage band. Everybody's competing. Everybody's saying, our garage band, we had a bass player that was just wildly playing bass, thinking like he was just like incredibly awesome. And then we had a drummer just banging away, you know. He was a really good drummer, very talented drummer. He went on to do a lot of bands, played in a lot of bands. And then we had guitar players. I was a guitar player, and I was just wailing away. And another guitar player wailing away. But all in our own world, trying to show you, I'm really, really good. Instead of, you know, playing a simple song and making it smooth and making it sound really like everything's in sync and harmony and all this kind of stuff. Wow. So, same thing. A spiritual focus practicing. Keep it simple. Keep it smooth. Keep it somewhat structured, okay? Someone has to be in charge. People have to accept someone's in charge here, okay? They're setting the song list. They're setting the tone. They're setting the instruments. They have to be the one that does that. And then you get the results. You start getting the results. I don't like to be the person in charge. I'm not a take charge person at all. So I shy away from that. You know, that's not my thing. That's not my thing. Because there's always so much pushback, isn't there? I mean, McCartney to this day says, you know, Lennon never said any of my stuff was any good. He never said, that's really, one time he said, that's pretty good, Paul. One time. He's still complaining about it when he's in his 70s or something. Sir Paul McCartney is like still like his ego still kind of really, really hurt. Like John Lennon never, he only said one time that's not bad, Paul, that's not bad. The rest of the time, he said, I don't think he liked my stuff. You know, I still got a lot to prove. So, you know, you get a lot of pushback, you know, when you're the one who's in charge. It's like, you know, they're not, everybody wants to lead. You can't have too many chefs in the kitchen. You know, you have to have a chef that says, look, you're doing this, you're cooking this, you're cooking this, you're cooking this. You got to have a chef that's in charge. And, you know, well, I don't know. I don't know if I could even do anything like that. I've never had any practice of being in charge of anything, actually. I tend to want to just let people do whatever the heck they want to do. You know, just, you know, freedom. You know, that's a little too much anarchy. You cannot have anarchy when you're trying to deal with really effective practicing. You got to know there's got to be expertise involved here, and you got to know where there's trouble spots. You know, it's just like the bass player. You got to rein that bass player in. You know, everybody has to subvert their, you know, their ego, submerge their ego. To get a really good song, you have to submerge your ego, because you got to know when to lay back, when to play soft. That's what's called studio musicians. They play without ego. They play just what makes the song sound great. Very rare to find musicians like that are really, wow. You know, they just, if they need to lay back and make it quiet and don't stay, they do it. Most people, they want to, you know, blast their part up, say, listen to this bass. You know? The song goes to heck. So the bass has to just almost like there's a way to make it unobtrusive that somehow just makes the whole pulse of the song so beautiful, right? And to where, know how to balance the sound to make it spacious, how to do that. This is a great artistry to that. And usually someone really took charge and says, okay, guys, you may hate me, but I'm going to just make all these decisions about, you know, volume and everything. And the rest of the guys are like, you know, if they have hit songs, they make a lot of money, but still they resent it. As musicians, it's crazy. They're the most grievance-ridden, temperamental people in the world, musicians, believe me. They hold grievances their whole lives of, like, you know, it's incredible. You know, he didn't let me play drums on this song. I wanted to play the drums louder, you know. It's like, they still resent it to this day. Oh, it's awful. Nothing more sensitive than musical sensibilities. People really feel like if I just am able to play it the way I want to, that's going to be it for me. That's it. That'll save me. I'll feel this perfect suitableness. No, you won't. No, you won't. You'll feel much better, actually, when you blend the music together and you get the great song. It's like, wow. You know, that song really has this wonderful balance and harmony and feel to it. That's what really sounds good. It's about the sound, not about the players. Okay, it's not about the players, it's about the sound you get. And here with us, it's about getting, actually removing these blocks, these vows, reversing these vows. Ultimately, so we actually begin to have direct experiencing. So the fifth step, ultimately we start to have this direct experiencing. Then you say, oh, that's what it's about. That's what it's about. And you say, oh, wow. You know, perfect suitability. Wow. How can that be described, perfect suitability? It's indescribable, right? Perfect suitability? How... You know, what is that? We can't, it's impossible to even relate to this from a materialistic standpoint. Perfect suitability? You know, how can you have time and have perfect suitability at the same moment? That's the end of time, isn't it? That's why you have to drop time in order to feel it. You can't feel time and feel perfect suitability at the same moment. You can't have this vow of time, I'm feeling time, and feel perfect suitability right now, because with perfect suitability, you don't have to wait for anything to get better, something to change. Don't need anything to happen one way or the other. If you appear perfectly suitable, there's no sense of needing time at all. No sense of needing time at all. So I don't know if it's even possible to rein in spiritual ambition to the point where people will listen to a practicing, have some structure to it, without you know, too much structure, but still pretty strong structure. This is the nomenclature we're going to use. We're working on reversing these vows. We have these five steps. We're staying within this structure. We don't overdo it. We never force the issue. All these things. But that's what religions are all about. People who join religions, they have to accept that there's a way to do it. And there's, you know, you have to really look at Buddha, all the laws, the rules of the Sangha that he laid down. 100 or so. I mean, so many. That you didn't do this, you didn't do this, you didn't do this, you didn't do this, you know, all the stuff. You had to accept those vows and work on it as best you can. and accept the authority of your teacher and the teacher's teacher and the teacher's teacher's teacher and the instructors and stuff. You had to be very humble and obedient to all that stuff. And so Buddha didn't mess around. He really set very strict guidelines for, you know, very strict. And these days, because of drugs, basically, people think, like, I don't need those guidelines. I just took this drug and I got it. What do I need these guidelines for? Yeah, but do you have it now? Right? Where's your momentum? How's your psyche actually structured and dealing with brisk momentum every day? Nah, man. I could get it whenever I want it. Meanwhile, I'm partying, having fun, and if I want that high, I know how to get that high. It's just like, it's no problem. Yeah, later on in life, we'll see how that works out. And we have plenty of examples now from the boomer generation, which was the beginning of the drug generation, the silent generation, which was before that. Let's say, what is it? 1929 or something to 1945, something like that. 1929, 1945, the silent generation. They didn't use drugs. They didn't take drugs. They did not take drugs. They did not. Then what happened was there were some hipsters that started using drugs in the 50s. Okay, hipsters started using drugs. That part of the silent generation did. There was a few of the silent generation that started using, abusing amphetamines. They got these inhalers for asthma, whatever, inhalers that had this tremendous amount of amphetamine in it. And they opened up the inhalers and used that amphetamine to get extremely whacked out on amphetamines. And then they had all these so-called pseudo-religious experiences and thought they understood spirituality, like, perfectly, and began trying to teach everybody about, like, you know, they're the Messiah. And that was the 50s. And then the 60s came along, and the boomers were influenced by the Beat Generation. It's called the Beat Generation, which were extreme drug addicts on amphetamines. Was their drug of choice. A little bit of heroin, mostly amphetamines from these inhalers, which were legal, over-the-counter, legal to do. And they taught the hippies, like, hey, you know, being God is easy. I know I'm God because I used this amphetamine inhaler and I realize I'm God. So then the hippies, the young boomers, grew up being influenced by the Beat Generation. They started getting into drugs very heavily. That's when more drugs came on the scene, started coming onto the scene in the United States, certainly. Certainly you had the pharmaceutical grade amphetamines in your mom's medicine cabinet, which were diet pills. For a ton of women in the 50s used diet amphetamines, pharmaceutical amphetamines, as diet pills. Very strong stuff. The kids would raid their mom's medicine cabinet for whatever that she had, you know. Yeah, take those. There was illicit trade in all sorts of amphetamines. People coming back from World War II certainly had amphetamine habits. And so the whole speed epidemic began building up with the hippie generation. The young kids just popping pills like crazy and thinking, like, they're gods. Oh, yeah, I realize I'm God. You know, right. That's what amphetamines do. They make you feel like you're God. And so... But the silent generation didn't do that so much. It was just a very small subgroup that the Beats, it was a very small subgroup, actually. But it really just boomed and mushroomed like crazy in the boomer generation. And it's been going strong ever since. That stuff gives people extreme overconfidence that they don't need any structure. I don't need to practice structure. What is that nonsense, you know? I just took this amphetamine just like that. I was super, I was God. I'm not going to spend, you know, 30 years of practice of a very steady, calm, you know, focused practice when I could just be God just like that. Who's going to do that? Crazy. You know, so there became what's called anti-authoritarian, where the whole history of religious endeavor was this somewhat structured path. Of pure, you got to be, you know, have pure habits, that don't interfere with your practicing. Your practicing can't be forced. You have to develop experience and maturity, and that you have to mature on the path so you can handle the greater, bigger insights. So it's all very much calibrated throughout history. Along came the amphetamines, and that all went out the window. Amphetamines are the most dangerous drug there is, really. And I know we've developed some really dangerous ones too, DMT, all these, you know, psychoactive, modern psychoactive drugs. But amphetamines, the people who took them reported them. They just said that what happens is it's like instant God, you know. Instantly I'm God. Everything is clear to me. My mind is crystal clear. Ideas are flowing like massive rivers, you know, and nothing can stop me. I'll never come down from this. I've got it forevermore. And that's amphetamines. And so the people used those just throughout all of this important structure to gain genuine psychological maturity. They threw it all out. They became super anti-authoritarian, super. I know I grew up in those times, and the mood was extremely anti-authoritarian because they said these old squares spent their life pounding their Bibles, you know, praying and doing the, you know, structured, graduated path. And here we did it in like, you know, instantly. What a bunch of idiots. We're so much superior to them. We just popped some speed and we went blasted right past these old squares, you know? These know-nothing squares, they called them. Old people were squares because they didn't turn on. They didn't use drugs. And they said, we're way more religiously hip than they are. I mean, they're still struggling with this stuff, and we're like realizing, you know, the whole universe is God. I'm God. Everything is God. You know, that's amphetamine. Amphetamines give you that sort of experience, according to those who use them and honestly reported on them. Some of the beats, you know, repented. Allen Ginsberg repented ultimately. He said it's the devil. He was one of the biggest advocates of amphetamines and the whole beat generation thing. Became very famous because of it. But later on, he totally recanted. He totally recanted. And he says, amphetamines are the absolute devil, period. Because, yeah, they lead you down this false path. And so, but we our generation boomers rebelled against any religious structure necessary for maturity. They says, I've got instant maturity. I'm because I'm just awesome. And ever since then, there's been this collapse of faith in proper structure towards maturation. They're saying that's too slow. Nobody does that anymore. Yeah. Well, nobody's really succeeding anymore much, are they? Right? In terms of saints, those who have genuinely realized stable, genuine, stable realization, that's very, very, very rare in this world right now. Extremely rare. Because we threw out the baby with the bathwater. And nobody was willing to take this long, hard road to get there. Everybody wanted this instant fix. You know, they said it's easy. Except for all the backlash and the side effects and the deterioration of their psyche. So if you look at these people, the boomers, spiritually right now, who continued the drugs and thinking that was it, most of them stopped, you know, and said, wow, this isn't it. But you realize, you look at these people, and you say, wow, they got stuck somewhere really bad. They got real stuck, extremely stuck. A few, you know, are still singing the praises. Yes, oh, no, I didn't get stuck. I'm so smart, I didn't get stuck. I'm the smartest of the smartest. I didn't get stuck. And they're stuck as heck, you know, stuck as heck, actually. Easy to tell when you, but the problem is there's so few of those in the world now who are mature, psychologically mature anymore, very rare, that there's hardly anyone to compare. There's hardly any comparison, so that maybe these drug people seem like, well, yeah, they seem like maybe they did get it. But when you are around someone who's genuinely mature, psychologically mature, then you see, there's a big difference. There's a huge difference. There's a huge difference between the ripeness and, you know, painting, like taking an unripe fruit and like painting it like ripe color, taking like some apple that's still green and then painting it red and then say, look at that, I'm so ripe, you know. Bite into it. You said, ah, come on, I don't want to bite into it. You know what are you talking about? It's like that, you know. Whereas a genuine red apple that's actually matured, you can bite into it and it's so sweet. It's absolutely sweet. Okay, so some are taking unripe fruit and painting it to make it look ripe. Here, we are accepting that we need more maturation. We need more ripeness. We know how to go about it. And we keep working on it every day. So just no universe to opt out of wow. 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 Just no world to opt out of wow. Just no body to opt out of wow. Just no time to opt out of wow. Just no universe to opt out of wow. Universe is an anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no world to opt out of wow. World is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no body to opt out of wow. Body is anomaly and anomaly is wow. Just no time to opt out of wow. Time is anomaly and anomaly is wow. So we get a little practice in here like that. Not too much, you know, don't overdo it. I tend to take breaks. You know, this is four step. You don't just do just four step. We have five different steps that we take. And so sometimes it's one, sometimes it's two, sometimes it's three, sometimes it's four, and five will come along when it comes along. That's the direct experiencing. So all five of these steps, we have to be aware of these and know where we're at. What are we doing? Are we doing theory right now? Okay, I just gave you a bunch of theory, a lot of theory about, you know, how to be savvy about the path and how not to be seduced by those who are painting unripe fruit ripe and claiming that you should believe that they've got it, they've got the maturity, they've got it, etc., when they may have been forcing the issues and are actually stuck and overcompensating. That's the second step. The first step is the wow. We could even put the wow into 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wow. That's nice. I like that. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wow. And a wow stands for all definition, all representation, all reaction, all past, all future hopes, all results. Okay, it stands for I've got it right here, right now, and it's wow. That's what I got. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wow. So that's the first foundational step. Second is some theory. Third is forgiveness practice and non-advanced practice. It's advanced, but it's not super advanced. I mean, it's really great practice. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of opting into time and opting out of now. You see, I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of opting into time and opting out of now. That's one way. So that's the third. And the fourth is the more advanced, you know, really super advanced practicing. And then the fifth would be the direct experiencing. So we kind of have to know where we're at and weave those together. Weave them together. You don't just do one or the other. We try to weave these together. And maybe at some point some direct experiencing might happen. For me, it doesn't happen very often, or it may be, you know, pretty quick. Just a brief glimpse like that, but sometimes it does happen. Often times where it will happen every day for just a little bit every day kind of sort of scenario. Other times it'll kind of be some breaks where it doesn't happen quite as often. And then the bigger breakthroughs, you know, who knows when they happen. When you reverse the vow of time is when they happen. And that, you know, when you're ready, somehow your will just suddenly feels like, oh, I got the will to do it. It's kind of like that. When you're ready for like to take a run, you suddenly feel like you feel strong today. I'm going to take a run. Sometimes you feel spiritually like, you know what? I feel like I'm going to just let go of time for now. And then you do it. That happens. That happens. The glue that holds all our entire absurdist vowing structure together. Time. Belief in time. Our absurdist vowing system. Vowing to keep on dying until we succeed. Vowing to never give up vowing to die until we succeed. Vowing to put up with all suffering and unsuitability until we succeed. Vowing to learn to love unsuitability until we succeed. Vowing to worship absurdity as God until we succeed. And vowing to, again, never touch any of these vows until we succeed. Those vows are really control all of us. Hard to start a good band. Everyone comes into a band, most usually, being pretty good and already knowing what they like, what they want to do. So I'm really good at this. I'll do this and this. How do you get a band with get a really unique sound that it all works properly when everybody is off on a different tangent? See, can't do it. So it's extremely difficult to get a really good musical band together. And to stay together, right? They creatively, you know, they always say, "Well, this is what I really want to do," and I just had to, you know, do what the band wanted me to do to make these hit songs. But I really want to do. I really want to do jazz. You know, I don't want to do pop. I hate pop. But pop is where the money is. Yeah. You get all these musicians, they end up doing something really different than what they used to do, and they say that they didn't really like that, what they used to do. No, that wasn't really me, but that's where the money was. So here the money is step 5, direct experiencing. And so in order to get to that, you got to pay the price, and you have to have some structuring in order to really get that brisk momentum going. That's ultimately going to start bringing these breakthroughs, and more you reverse this vow of time more and more, and one insight settles it all, one reversal settles it all, and coming to accept that this one reversal does indeed settle it all, and accepting that and saying, okay, I know I just reversed the vow of time, I forgive myself, I relinquish the vow of believing in time and not believing in now. relinquish the vow of believing in time and not accepting now. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of believing in time and not accepting now. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of believing time accomplishes impossible. Wow. Forgive myself and relinquish the vow of impossible being accomplished by time. No, it doesn't work. Time being accomplished by impossible. Wow. So many people walking here. And there's just so many. Everybody's out walking. I haven't taken any walk yet at all. Got to do this stuff. This is more important. You know. Maybe the weather's picking up now. It's really warm. 70 here. It was like 70, I think about 72 today. It's going to go up to 74, 75, 79, probably 80, and then down, and then it's going to go back down to cooler mid-60s. But we're going to get a burst of spring here in California. A lot of pollen out in the air, a lot. I was sneezing this morning. I was like, uh-oh. And you know, so don't want to start sneezing, feeling kind of tired and achy and sneezing. It's like, uh-oh. But you know, hopefully it is indeed, allergy, pollen, stressing the immune system. It really stresses. I got to remember to drink, use local honey. We have local honey here with the pollen in it. It hasn't been, you know, homogenized or purified from the pollen. It's got all the local pollen in it. And I was taking that every day. I need to get back to doing that. Very important. And that's supposed to help your immune system, because heavy pollen lowers your immunity to a great extent, and that's when viruses can really get into you, troubles can get into you. So rare is it that you find a musician that will just do whatever, you know, the overall concept of what we want to accomplish. He'll just say, whatever you want me to do, I'm just happy to do just that. Because I'm interested in the overall finished sound of it all. And not, I don't even have to be, you know, noticeable in what I'm doing at all. It's a little tambourine or background vocals or, you know, whatever you want. I'll just fill it in and just enjoy the whole experience of being part of something, of making some hit records. That's really more satisfying than anything else, it seems like, really. To look back and say, you know what? You know, made some really big hit songs that are just tremendous, and we all just fit in, you know, in the right way. Just did it that way. Wow. So I go to Coach Dila and I say, Coach, whatever you want me to do, the practice, I'll do the practice. Doesn't matter how simple it is. You want me to count to five? I'll count to five. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wow. Whatever you want, you know, I'm happy to do it. I'm happy to do it. But again, the overconfidence from drugs is the big problem in the world right now. The problem, the way to describe it, what's really fueling this wildfire in the world is overconfidence in people. Lack of humility. Lack of being grounded in realizing just how tough the path really is and how important it really is. And you can't mess around wasting your time. You got to get that down to work. And lacking that humility has led to extreme overconfidence. Extreme overconfidence. Confidence. Young people just feel like, you know, I could do it all. I can do it all really fast. No problem. I got this. This is what I need an answer. Just Google it. Just Siri, give me the answer. How do you get enlightened? Oh, I got it. See, this is insane overconfidence. It's beyond overconfidence. It's just absolute folly, actually. But so, how do you get someone who's incredibly, insanely overconfident? How do you get him just to play a tambourine in your band? You know, they're not going to do that. They're saying, "Give me the mic," you know. Hey everybody, you know, and I'm the lead singer, you know, I'm you know, the front person of this band. I can't lose. I'm so over. This is the thing. Everybody wants to be a rock star now, and they say it's easy. Siri, how can I be a rock star? Oh, okay, I got it. I got this. And okay, so that's the trouble. It's extreme overconfidence. People not willing to say, hey, you know what? I don't have a clue. I don't have a clue, really. I don't know anything. I don't know. I don't have a clue. And, you know, just take it one step at a time. Everybody's in so much of a hurry, right now. You've got to fix this world in 10 years, you know. So they're not going to say, hey, maybe I'll be practicing, you know, for most of my life. And ultimately, I'll start seeing results will ultimately come. I got a lot of blocks, a lot of vows I have to reverse. You need a lot of maturity to reverse the deepest vows, those especially time. You need tremendous maturity to do that properly. And then to keep it reversed, it is then a step beyond, you know, tremendous maturity. That's just the real icing on the cake. And you know, you're not going to get to that with this extreme overconfidence of the younger generations. They just think like, you know, everything should show up, you know, like that for them. It doesn't work that way on the spiritual path. Or, well, reversing our death vows, you know, reversing our absurdist, useless, absurdist vows. It doesn't work like that. It never will. It never will. There's no way that's going to work. So overconfidence just blacks out everything. Just blacks out our psychologically, we black out and become superficial, very superficial and weird. Whereas if you have the silent generation was much more, they were very earnest and worked very hard on psychologically working on it. They were, you know, they realized I got a lot of, this is going to take a long time. I got to do a lot of work. And they're very structured and earnest about it. You know, and they made a lot of headway. They made a lot of headway. Very great generation, the silent generation, actually. So with this massive stall out, you get this push of like things become extremely superficial and we feel like we should be able to solve everything right now. And you see that in the coronavirus thing. Like the way that I look at it, I'm looking at it, you know, in what I hope to be an objective, balanced, mature way. Say, okay, and not Monday morning quarterbacking, armchair quarterbacking, right? Revisionism saying, you should have done it faster. That's what all that we're hearing right now. You should have done it. Every leader in every country is hearing this backlash from these people who are too overconfident about they think they can do everything that's like this. You know, they should have just Googled it and you should have known what to do and you should have done it earlier. Well, I guarantee you that if you did mitigation like in January right away, these same people would say, you should have done it in December. And if you did it in December, they said you should have done it last. You should have done it in 2018. What's the matter with you? And if you did it then, they'd say you should have been planning for this 10 years ago, you idiot. You know, you can't win with these people. Okay, there's no end winning game with them because they're just telling themselves, I could have done it like that. It's easy. Doing all this stuff's easy. Just Google it, and you should be able to just know exactly what to do. And so they start Monday morning quarterbacking of criticizing every last thing you do. Say, well, how come you didn't do it faster? What's the matter with you? Like me, I do everything fast. Well, what they are is they're overconfident really fast. That what they specialize is in overconfidence, and they do that really, really fast all the time. So a lot of the older generation is looking at this, what's going on in the world, and say, what is the matter with people, you know? Looking how it unfolded, I thought they went too fast. I said, man, you know, they went extremely fast. So I'm not saying you should have gone faster. I said, man, you went really fast. Who could have foreseen exactly how it was going to unfold, right? So it's easy to criticize. Looking back, but in the heat of the moment, it's an entirely different scenario. And you could see the immaturity of people, of they're just obsessed with carping about the past. How come you didn't do it different? That's called revisionism. It's a disease. It's a severe psychological disease, revisionism. And it hits people so badly. And they talk, everything now is, well, how, you know, like civil rights. Well, how come you didn't do it earlier? And then you say, well, we did, you know, how come it wasn't earlier? Well, how come it wasn't done before? Well, how? Always one-upping, saying, look, you know, you should have done it faster. Doing it faster is what is the only way. And it's never fast enough, though. It's never fast enough. It's never early enough for them. It's never good enough. You realize that. And so people are scratching their heads saying, these people, nothing satisfies them. It's never good enough for them. Because they feel they should be able to feel totally suitable, but they should be able to just Google it and it should be right now. And if the fact that it isn't, it's somebody else's fault. If somebody only would mitigated the coronavirus like, you know, 3 months earlier, I'd be feeling like perfect right now, right? So the fact that they don't feel perfect right now is somebody else's fault because somebody didn't do something quick enough in the past. So we're all under this insane pressure by these people. It's not only the younger generation, it's some of the older generation who use drugs who have nothing but criticism for everybody. You can never please them. You can never please them. Unless you become some sort of cult idol that tells them that what they're doing is exactly right. All this revisionism you're doing, that's really great. You're really on track, you know. Whereas someone says, hey, folks, this is immaturity on your part. They hate that. But if someone comes along, a real clever demagogue, real slick, clever demagogue, and says, hey, all you hipsters, you know, I love what you're doing. It's so helpful. It's helping the whole world. If we were all this way, we'd be perfect. Then they fall into what's called idolatry of this demagogue, and they fall into a cult of idolatry. They're saying what I want to hear. Yeah, you know, I don't need to change psychologically. I'm totally mature. It's all the rest of the people who are immature. And so that's what happened in this world, actually, and could happen again going forward, actually. Very dangerous scenario is someone come along and pandering to these people who are stuck in this very severe immaturity of saying, yeah, you're right. All those rest of those guys, they're so wrong. They're such idiots. They should have done it way faster and quicker. What's the matter with those idiots? You know, let's really smash them, you know. And you're right, you know, you're so mature and so smart. You did it, you think so fast, and you're so... They lap that up, you know, because that means, hey, I don't have to realize that the habits that I have are stalling me out. I don't have to discipline myself, be responsible for what I'm experiencing, how I feel. I don't have to do anything of that at all. All I have to do is pin the blame on some other group. And this demagogue is saying, it's okay to pin the blame on some other big group, you know, people. Those people are wrong. They're bad. They're not hip enough. They're old. They're square. They're not hip enough. They don't understand. Everything should be done faster. Yeah. And then if someone's willing to say that, be a demagogue, then people will worship that demagogue psychologically. They become psychologically fixated on that person. Terrible scenario. That's the collective consciousness of this globe. That's some of the dynamics that take place here. And if you try to be the adult in the room, those type of people will hate you. They'll hate you. How dare you say that you did it in a reasonable manner at a reasonable moment? How dare you say that? You know, you're a horrible person for saying that. That you should have done it way faster and way quicker. If you're on amphetamines, you would have seen so. You know, we got so many people now on amphetamines. Half of college students use amphetamines during their college days, especially to study and to take exams. Half, and it's probably more than half. And when they do so, you know, they think like, you know, I'm someone really special, really, really special, because I can figure everything out really, really fast. In fact, I can figure it out right now, right now. And I've always had it figured out right now. That's where it's part of where it's coming from. Very, very, very strongly. The amphetamization of young people right now is intense, intense. I talk to young people, they say, oh yeah, everyone takes it. So many of us take it. So many of us. Super, super common, super easy to get. Say, no problem. I ask them, can you get these drugs? They say, totally easy to get all these drugs. No problem whatsoever. With the internet, knowing how these kids know how to use it, they said, we can get any drug we want like that. And then they say, but I know my friends who are on these, so many really hardcore drugs I know are really dangerous, and they're on all of them. And they can get them just like that, no problem. So a lot of the younger people are very worried about their friends who are really on heavy, heavy amounts of drugs, okay? This messes up culture to an extreme extent, messes it up very, very badly, extremely badly. It's the reason why we're having the problems we're having in the world right now. 100 years of intense drug usage by the population of this planet, starting about 100 years ago, which, you know, the Weimar Republic was heavily using synthetic drugs of heroin, for instance, and cocaine. And then ultimately in the 30s, amphetamines came into the world picture in a big way. But before that, it was intense cocaine, intense use of cocaine and heroin around the world, actually. And then the downers also using, mixing amphetamines with barbiturates and uppers with a downer, so that you really felt like you were really under control. That was the in the swinging 60s in England, they had these pills that were a mixture of amphetamines and barbiturates. And so you could just go days and days and days and days. What happened was they'd get the weekends and they'd just fly from Friday afternoon all the way through the weekend, never sleeping, just partying and like crazy. And then be able to go to work on Monday because the barbiturates kind of smoothed out the experience for them. That was the swing in 60s in London. That's what was happening there. And all the musicians were taking those drugs. And the partiers were taking the drugs. Yeah, the rockers and the mods, the different types of people. But the mods, I think, were very heavy amphetamine users. And these, what was it, Purple Hearts or something they were using to the barbiturate amphetamines. Very, very, they all took them. They get on their motor scooters, and the whole weekend they were just flying. But under seemingly some sort of control because of the barbiturates there. See, this is the thing. So this has been going on. Drug use, heavy drug use among young people has been going on for the last 100 years. And this has psychologically warped the psychology of people in this world, has warped it to an extreme extent. And now we're experiencing the fruits of that in this world because nobody has the brakes. Institutionally, psychologically, we don't have the brakes to manage the world properly anymore. And you're seeing that it's just falling apart. Nobody can do anything without just getting viciously attacked. You know, you should have done it differently. You should have done it better. You should have done it sooner. You should have done it faster. You're an idiot. You could never please these people at all. It's impossible. You cannot please them. It's impossible. Unless you tell them they're absolutely right and that they should blame everybody for being these other people who don't do what they think as an idiot. And then they say, oh, my God, somebody really understands me. You know, and if you keep feeding that, you know, then you get this codependency, idolater codependency, cult-like situation, which has already happened in the United States and in the world, indeed, has already happened. And saying that it's perfectly okay, you know, to feel that way. You should. Yeah, history was all wrong. Everything in history was wrong. Everybody did it wrong. But you would have done it right. You see, that's what they love to hear. You would have done it right if you would have been in charge. But these idiots in history were in charge. They did it completely wrong. Yeah, you know, right. That's called revisionism. It's a disease, a psychological disease. But if you really went back there, you know, you'd realize, well, people did it the way they did it because that's the way that it was psychologically structured for everybody back at that time. This is the perspective that everyone had. Okay, they didn't. So you take your perspective now and then go back in the past, especially the drug-based perspective, the whole entire past seems like completely crazy. They should have, you know, done everything completely differently. Whereas if you're psychologically mature, you say, no, they did things the way that they perceived them and it was appropriate for the times. It now we may see with different values, we think like, well, they shouldn't have done that. But back at that time, that was, people felt they were doing the best they could do. Back at that time, we're always doing the best that we feel we can do. Okay, this is a fact. If you look at every person in the world, they're actually doing the best that they see that they can do. They are. They're doing the best that they see the way they're perceiving, the way their vows are, the way their psyche is. They're doing the best that they can do. That's a fact. And it's been that way throughout history. Nobody is not trying to do the best that they can do, actually. They're just trying to function the best that they can function based on how they're perceiving, you know, what their vows are like, what their psychological structure is like. That's constraining them. And our structure can get, you know, this way and that way. And so to look back and say all the people in history are so wrong, that's a very immature perspective. They did the best they could at that time. We should do the best that we can do at this time. Instead of insisting that, you know, blaming everybody in the past for our immaturity right now. No, our immaturity right now is because we're taking too many drugs. We're rejecting all wise historical authority and how to structure our time properly and how to have patience to realize this reversing of vows takes patience. It takes great effort. It takes humility. It takes, you know, all perseverance. It takes long suffering. instead of rejecting and say all these people were idiots in the past, you know, we need that maturity now. We needed to do the best that we can do now. And right now, it's, you know, maybe some people look in history, you know, look back and say, those people did this horrible. How could they? Idiots. Well, drugs. Young people are using drugs now more than ever. They've got a vast more array of drugs. And this sets a very wrong foundation for your life when you're doing that. They're chugging energy drinks like crazy. Energy drinks are extremely bad for you psychologically. Extremely bad. They think nothing of that. They're so hopped up. They're so overconfident. And they're so revisionistic. You know, and they say everything, we should be able to solve everything just right now. Just give us the right leader and just, you know, everything's free and every problem is solved and the rest of the history is a bunch of idiots. We know the answer. Okay, that is immaturity. That is immaturity. There have been a lot of people in history who have reversed their vows, psychological vows, their death vows, and gotten free of death, of the belief in time, and have experienced their true home. And have therefore gotten free of the cycles of birth and death, gotten free of this dream, this death dream. A lot of people have done it in the past. They explained how they did it and got a lot of people on the path towards doing this. And that's what we have to keep doing. And this is what's not happening right now, because the interference with drugs is the number one culprit by far. By far, if you took away all the drugs, if drugs never happened in this world, you can't even imagine how much better the world would be, actually. How much more psychologically mature the world would be. It would be almost incomprehensible how more psychologically mature we would be if none of those drugs had happened. All right? I mean, drugs did start in the World War, in the Civil War, for instance, morphine. That was there. It used to be an alcohol. You get wounded in battle, it's just you drink alcohol. the stronger, the better. Then it became, in Civil War, it became morphine. So that's what they had. That you get, they do amputations. Everything was morphine. Surgery, morphine. Wounds, infections, morphine, 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 morphine. Then it became cocaine. Cocaine was the next super drug. And then heroin was synthesized, and it became heroin. Along with cocaine became the two really, really big drugs. And then finally along came amphetamines in the 1930s, and that became the super drug among the hipsters. The hipsters said, hey, heroin, no, that's not it. It's amphetamines. I said, wow. Okay. And then they say to the kids, hey, kids, here's some pot, here's some marijuana, Start out, get used to the high. You're not mature enough to handle these amphetamines like we are. And then they gradually get them into drug culture. And then ultimately they started taking amphetamines. And then now they realize, I'm more enlightened than you are. And then they get some books and they say, I can memorize this spiritual book in one night. So they stay up all night memorizing these spiritual books. And next day, they're explaining to everybody, blah, 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 Buddha said this, blah, 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 blah. Everybody say, my God, this person's like some sort of guru. No, they were taking amphetamines, memorizing these books, and coming off like they were God. Fooled a lot of us, We didn't understand it was amphetamines. We didn't know. A lot of us, we didn't have any amphetamines in our family. We didn't even use medicine or drugs. We were like Christian Scientists. We didn't use drugs. So I didn't know what amphetamines were and what they were causing and any of this stuff. So I said, how do these people be so brilliant? Well, now I know, because I finally got the right information about what the whole story was. And I can tell you now, because I've studied it. Holy Spirit had me study it very intensely. Say, this is what happened, actually. And now I realized that they were just cramming, like students cram for finals with amphetamines, because you can remember all this stuff and be able to regurgitate it and get great grades. So they stay up all night reading these books, and it's like, I got it, These people were reading spiritual books, taking drugs, amphetamines especially, reading spiritual books, remembering the verbiage of it and the idea of verbiage and stuff, and then regurgitating all that stuff and seeming like they're so holy and so advanced and so amazingly brilliant, spiritually brilliant. Oh my gosh, they were so brilliant. Way better than anyone else in history. Well, they were cheating, weren't they, with amphetamines and coming off like they were so advanced, when in fact, no, they were just regurgitating stuff. They didn't have the actual maturity, psychological maturity wasn't there. And they fooled so many people, didn't they? Badly scarred. So many of us scarred by believing these people were so advanced. They were just low-down cheaters, you know? Yeah. Faking it. Just low-down cheating fakers. And they, you know, really caused a lot of problems. And we're cracking down on those right now. Very much cracking down on that. The reckoning is coming. The reckoning is coming on that. And so we are now, you know, realize what really has to be done, the right way to do it, and doing it. And at some point, you know, that will succeed. And the ones that did it the right way will ultimately succeed and get the fruits of that. And at some point, put the entire situation back on a stable basis. But as long as there's this massive drug use in the world, you can't put it on a stable basis, actually. And, of course, the more people use drugs, the more they insist everybody should use them. All right. So you can understand my brilliance, you know. So it makes it feel me. I feel okay about doing it because everybody else is doing it. So it must be okay. If everyone else is doing it, how could it be bad? You know, that was another 66. Everybody's doing it. That can't be bad. Until all the overdoses, until all the burnouts, to all the freakouts, to all the crime, until all the madness descended upon us at the end of the 60s, right? Yeah. It got completely out of hand. And then we just like, oh my gosh. And then along came cocaine. Everybody said, speed, you know, amphetamines, barbiturates, all the stuff of the psychedelics. Bunch of idiots. This is a much better drug, cocaine. Until that flamed out, right? And then along came what? Methamphetamine. You know, my God, you guys were so unenlightened back then. You know, we're so superior to you. We're using methamphetamine, crystal meth. Crystal meth. Yeah, that really, you know, cooking it up. It's homegrown, organically, locally sourced, organic crystal meth. Wow. Well, not so organic, but it's locally sourced. It must be really hip to have locally sourced stuff. And then, you know, along came all the designer drugs, too. So many designer drugs, and people think I'm ecstasy came along, the whole rave ecstasy scene. And people thought, you know, I'm just tuned into the universe. I'm completely one with the universe. I'm so tuned into it. You know, I can never lose this. Well, and now it's somebody else's fault. You know, you should have done it faster because I feel terrible. And it's your fault. The only way to appease those people? You're so right. You're so amazing. It's incredible. It's such an honor to be, you know, a leader of such amazingly advanced people. You're so advanced. You're right. Everybody in the past was so incredibly wrong who tried to do it without drugs, who tried to do it the right way. Those are a bunch of idiots, you know. But we know better now, don't we? That, you know, then those people, yeah. That's what I want to hear. And then things get even worse, and you try to fix it, and everybody hates you. So trying to be the adult in the room now it's almost a non-starter right now. It's almost a non-starter. So I don't know how much can be done. If you try to be the adult in the room, you're going to probably run into a buzzsaw possibly, you know, of difficulty, a buzzsaw difficulty. And certainly nobody wants that. Nobody is going to put up with that. No adult's going to say, oh yeah, I want that sort of trouble. No. Don't want that at all. We want, you know, geez, thanks for the great effort you've made in the past, everyone. We greatly appreciate all your efforts throughout history. And we know it's not been easy for you because you did the best you could do back then to try and reverse these vows. You worked on it really hard, and our capacity to do it now is based on the work that you did back then. All those wonderful people who tried to be as psychologically sophisticated as they possibly could in the right way, in a maturing way, they helped us out immensely. So we acknowledge all the help that they did, you see, that way. And great appreciation for everyone in the history who has really made some effort, you know, to really try to reverse these absurdist death vows. Vows to do the impossible and never quit until we succeed. So everyone who's done that, every single, we benefited from that intensely. And now we're able to be mature at this point, mature, because of their all the efforts of those in the past and also our efforts right now also. Combined together. And we're having able to be somewhat mature at a time right now when everybody else is losing their heads. Not an easy thing to do, to say the least, right? Not an easy thing to do. So hopefully this is helping you. Just hearing this is you realize that there is still some maturity possible. There is some perspective possible. We do understand that you know, things have gotten off track. And why have they gotten off track? You know, how come, is there some way possible to get them stay on track or to get them back on track, or at least for me to stay on track? Can I at least not get swept into the madness of the times, right? That it's going to get crazy, folks. It's going to get really crazy. Is there some way I can not get swept away into that craziness? Is there some way I can avoid idolizing some demagogue, you know, some political demagogue that, you know, is totally into revisionism and catering to my drug habits and my overconfidence and all that kind of stuff? And is there some way to avoid that, or am I going to get sucked into that? You know, it's tricky, you know. It's tricky to avoid that. It's tricky because it plays on your weaknesses, and you always think, no, it's not me, it's someone else. It's not me, it's someone else. Very tricky. So if you're in the blame game, you're in trouble. If you're in the blame game, you're in trouble. If you're in the drug game, you're in trouble. If you're in the overconfidence game, you're in trouble. I mean, big trouble. So we want to avoid that, or if we're into that, we want to like wake up and say, hey, wait a minute, I got to get out of this like right now. I got to get out of this right now. Just make that decision. It's possible to make that decision. I've certainly done that in the past. I just make suddenly realize, you know what? This is too much trouble. I'm done. And then boom, that's it. And never look back on it. Never look back. I'm done. This I can see. I don't want to go there. That's going to be too weird, too much trouble. I'm done. And pivot, and you find something, and now your attention is on this. You say, this is better. This is way better. This is way better. So hopefully we're presenting a spiritual path that's way better, that you could see, you know what, this is balanced. This is some structure to it. There's some hope to it. I don't need to try to force results. Results will come automatically. There is a way to reverse these vows. And one vow, reversing the vow of time, does indeed settle it all. So there is a way to settle it all when I can get to that. So it's a certain remedy. That's a certain remedy we have. And so we've got our eyes on the prize. We realize that it will subside. And it subsides all at once when we reverse the vow of time. It subsides all at once, and that subsides into this great smoothness. You feel totally smooth. It feels totally suitable for you. Okay, totally suitable. All of that is there. That we have our sights on that. You know, it's very clear about that. And you know, so, and brisk momentum, middle pathing, or brisk momentum. And keeping on track. So can we keep on track during these times? That's the big challenge. I'm not totally confident I can stay on track. I'm not confident anyone can stay on track at this point. I am not. Don't know. It may get to the point where we can't stay on track. That the way it's going right now, you got to realize that's possible. And so I say, wow, okay. Help. You know, help the great teachers, help us out, because I can't guarantee I'm going to stay on track, and I don't have confidence that anyone else can actually stay on track as this unfolds. What's going on in the world as this is unfolding, I could see people are psychologically struggling badly. People who are actually quite mature are still struggling badly. You can tell they're really trying to hold on. But at the same time, they're stalling out. The momentum isn't there. So here, we're trying to keep the momentum going. Okay, that you have to keep the momentum going, or otherwise you're in big problem. Any great spiritual teacher will tell you, you must keep your momentum going until you finish. Don't think you can get really mature but not finish. Finishing means reversing the vow of time and forgiving that vow entirely and staying that way. That's called finishing. And you must keep your momentum brisk until you finish. You cannot get close to finishing and stall out. That's a no-no. That's a big no-no. And so for a lot of us, we may be close to finishing, and yet we haven't finished yet. And now here comes this colossal stall out. The perfect excuse to not finish, to fail, to reverse the vow of time, the glue that holds all our vows together, to fail to do that, that's failure. Doesn't matter if you get close. Close isn't good enough. Close isn't good enough on the spiritual path. You have to finish. So I haven't finished. I'm close, but I haven't finished. So I'm concerned about stalling out. I could stall out. Definitely could stall out. So I'm saying, hey, you know, bigwigs, gurus, coaches, help me out. Help me out. I'm in big trouble. I don't want to stall out now. I'm too close to stall out. If I stall out, that's a disaster for me. Disaster. All the effort I made stalled out. And then going spiraling down into just, you know, total weirdness and overconfidence and every kind of psychological distortion possible. And which is, the world is glorifying that. You get these demagogues who glorify it. They say, yeah, that's it. Being really weird, really distorted, really messed up, really drugged out, really overcome. That's it. You finally got it. You know, congratulations, man. We're going to make the world, you know, great. Make the world, you know, in that image, in like that. So you could, so to glorify that, we're going to make the world glorify that. Those are the demagogues, and they'll sweep you up like that. There's always those people around waiting for the moment to tell everybody who's messed up, no, you're not messed up. That's it. You know, let's glorify that. And then, you know, they become really famous, historically famous and powerful. And people say, well, what a great, unbelievable person they are. One of the best ever. You know, they really got it. Yeah. That'll happen. That'll happen. That'll happen. Big danger of that happening. No question about it. Because there's a ton of people who are already part of that cult who are think that blaming that someone else, you know, as soon as that blame can stick, they've got it, you know. So they're already, it's already being done, and they don't even realize it. They don't even realize it. But that can become much more severe as you go forward. People will have desperation to be told that their extremely distorted psychological state is it. They'll be desperate for that. And you know that these psychopathic sociopaths, demagogic sociopaths, they're sociopaths actually, will arrive on the scene and say, folks, indeed, you've got it. And I'm going to make sure everyone realizes that you've got it. Okay? And we got to make an omelet. We got to bust some eggs. Bust some eggs, right? Crack some eggs. If we got to bust some heads, we'll do it. Like that. And yeah. That's a huge, 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 huge likelihood coming up. That, and you know, it again. There's people that think that no. You know, we're good. The other guys are bad, and we just got to pin it on them, and then everything will be fine. They're already the drug users. Those people who have used drugs extensively. Already their personalities are so distorted, they just want someone to tell them that drugs are great. Anyone who says drugs are wonderful, let's legalize them all. You know, that's what they want to hear. That kind of demagogue. You know, now let's everybody be hip swingers. You know, that's the answer. Forget about those old religious values. To heck with those bunch of ignorant hillbillies. You know, clinging to their Bibles. They're a bunch of idiots. You know, they don't understand how advanced we are. See, that's the danger. That's the kind of demagogue that comes along who criticizes the old ways and say, those old ways were so stupid. Those people, you know, the religious people, so stupid. They're such slow turtles. They don't know how to, you know, we're the fast rabbits. Boy, we've got it. That's where it comes from. That's where it comes from. forget about, you know, patience and diligence and prudence and long-suffering and chastity and purity and all those things. Those are like, that's for a bunch of idiots back then, right? Idiots. We're the hip swingers, man, and, you know, we should be ruling and putting those people out of their misery, right? Putting them out of their misery. That's what's coming in huge amounts, unless we really crack down on this somehow. So we don't want to over-practice here, right? We've done a lot of practicing, advanced practicing in this video, a lot of theory, a lot of perspective here, a lot of warnings and, you know, and appeal. We need to appeal to help. Coach Nilam, we'll take all the help you've got. Coach us up. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Wow. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of believing in time and rejecting now. I forgive myself and relinquish the vow of believing in time and relinquishing now. Okay. And I got to get someone dinner. And the light is getting less out there, but the light's staying light a really long time, isn't it? That's great. A really nice backlighting today. It was really, really great. So we did do 2 hours. managed to get inspired enough to do that. And hopefully you've realized, hey, there is a mature, more mature perspective possible. You know, there is this more mature perspective possible that's based on understanding the real difficulty it is to reverse these deep subconscious vows that we have that are really just controlling us to such an extreme extent. There is a way to do this. There's a mature way. And so my efforts in this direction will certainly be rewarded ultimately. I need to put effort in these directions. The great teachers are certainly in agreement with this kind of presentation of humility, of patience, of long-suffering, of doing it the way that actually works, and to avoid overconfidence and all that. Every great teacher has stressed this, and I've made, you know, an entire lifetime of listening to these teachers and hearing what they had to say and accepting what they had to say and trying to follow it, you know, what they had to say. And so there, you know, hopefully it just helps out a little bit. You say, wow, you know what? Avoiding demagoguery. Just avoid it in every which way. You know, if you're wondering, like, well, maybe they're the ones. Just you say, okay, let me just avoid it here and here and here and here. Let me not get into any demagoguery. And let me not get entranced by the people who can blah, blah, blah spirituality in terms of, you know, I could, the Bhagavad, you know, this spiritual book says this, wow, yeah, I've got it. You know, whoa, easy with that. Let's go with these 5 steps, a little bit of structure here, okay, a little structure. Theory is just, that's just the second step. We got 5 steps here that are all important, need to be balanced in all these steps. Not just someone who's great at theory. Look, be very wary of that. Be very wary of that. Very wary. That trips so many people up badly, badly, badly. It's happened over and over and over and over again. No, someone who's, we need to be very good at the wow practice and blocking panic, okay, blocking all elaboration. Humbly do the wow practice. Very good at right theory. Of explaining that there's these death vows, okay, and understanding that we have these vows we must reverse. And that this death dream is futile. It's absolutely futile. It gets us nowhere. And then third, forgiveness practice. Make sure you're doing forgiveness practice. Forgiveness is the answer. Forgive yourself. Be very kind and gentle to yourself. Forgive yourself for all the immaturity that you've had in the past. And then number 4 is these very advanced practices that I'm getting from Coach Nilam here and sharing them. These are very, very advanced practices, very helpful practices, to say the least. And then the 5th is understanding we will have some breakthroughs. And our breakthroughs are what? Our breakthroughs are wow. never forcing the breakthroughs, understanding do not force the breakthroughs under any circumstances, and then therefore the necessity to make sure we stay away from all those various ways to try to force things. We stay away from, you know, the demagogues who tell us it's perfectly fine. We're so advanced our immaturity is it. It's not. Okay. Stay away from the drugs. Stay away from trying to force things. And do the best you can, right? Every day today, keep brisk momentum. So there's this structure and maturity to here to what we're presenting, that we have to stay within this structure and maturity. Have to stay within this. Someone here is telling us, okay, so let's keep some balance here. Let's not over practice this. Okay, let's not under practice. Let's not over practice. That's really important to do that, understand that. Let's be patient with ourselves. Let's not be try to be rock stars. Don't be in too much hurry to be a rock star, spiritual rock star. Keep that balance going. Keep that momentum going. Keep that momentum going every single day, right? And also the understanding that success is possible. I've been told for sure by my coaches, for sure you're going to succeed eventually. For sure, no question about it. So, okay, I have to keep working at it because I haven't succeeded yet. Haven't reversed the vow of time and kept it reversed yet. I've reversed it on quite a few occasions, but I haven't kept it reversed. Okay, and that all other vows, then if you keep it time reversed, that vow, all other vows will subside. All other vows will subside. But the coaches say, keep working at it. You're going to get it. I say, when? I don't say when. I say, okay, coach. All right, I'll work at it today as best I can. That's all. And then the wild card is, what are the zone five great coaches? What are they going to do for us? The ones who are willing to pursue this maturity, what are they going to do for us to help us out? Because we're going to need help. Because the immature people and the demagogues who are exploiting that immaturity for their own grandiose ideas of being historically important, they're going to cause a lot of trouble. They've already caused a lot of trouble. They're going to cause much more trouble down the road. When they get in power, right now they're not in power so much, and they're hating that fact. They're hating that fact. But when they really get the reins of power back, which eventually they will, they're going to cause massive trouble. Massive trouble for those of us who seem to be to them, you know, just obstructing their greatness, the realization of their greatness, which they feel should happen today, right? Because their drugs have told them, you know, it should be easy and quick. Yeah, they should be able to. It's just someone else is to blame for my feeling this unsuitableness, you know. So when they find out who to blame and how to fix the blame on them and how to punish them suitably, they figure, then they say, and then everything will be fine. And then it's basically, you know, rerun of World War II, right? The Germans took so many amphetamines, they were on a collective amphetamine psychosis, the Germans. In order to recover from their disastrous World War I debt reparation, the ruination of their country, the government passed out amphetamines to everybody and encouraged its use to an extreme extent. They became workaholics, worked like crazy, economic miracle, okay? But they were went on a collective amphetamine psychosis. Said, someone's to blame. We're going to pinpoint the blame. Okay, we're going to punish them, and once we get rid of all the evildoers, those that cause all the problems, and we'll get rid of them and punish them effectively, we're going to feel perfect. We're going to feel perfect. Then the Third Reich will spread throughout the world, and everyone will have a utopia in the world. They believed it. They actually believe there's a collective amphetamine psychosis going on there. And we got an even bigger collective amphetamine psychosis coming in this world now, to 10 times worse. Amphetamine use brings about a collective psychosis like no other drug. We don't even understand how bad that can be, but we're going to find out. It entrains other people. So those who are on amphetamines entrain others into their psychological psychosis, like this is possible. We could fix everything now. And you create a collective amphetamine psychosis, even among those that don't use amphetamines, they get swept up into it. Not all the Germans used amphetamines. A lot of them did. But the ones, even the ones that didn't use it, got swept up into this collective amphetamine psychosis. Psychosis can become very infectious, worse than coronavirus, extremely infectious. And nothing is more infectious or dangerous than collective amphetamine psychosis. And the world is likely to get swept up into this massive collective amphetamine psychosis. People have very low resistance to it right now. And then you're going to have really bad trouble here. So I'm aware of this. My coaches are certainly extremely aware of this. I was told by what you would say, the Holy Spirit, the inner guru, to study this and be very, very aware of this collective amphetamine psychosis situation in the world, because it's coming up and it's going to be really bad, and you have to understand what's going on. You have to be wise about it. So I've spent a tremendous amount of time studying this issue. And it was pointed out to me that this is very important. You have to do this. So this is, again, big, huge, huge number one issue in the world is a collective amphetamine psychosis, a psychological collective amphetamine psychosis, and people will hardly understand what in the heck is going on. And having gone through it already in the 60s and the 70s, you know, I understand how bad it can be. And you're going to end up like, you know, feeling like you've lost your dignity, you've lost your bearings. You know, what happened to me, the person I wanted to really be, become really, the spiritual person I really wanted to become, what happened to it? Swept away in a tsunami somehow. I don't even know what happened. But now we're hip to what is likely to happen. And we're going to work on remedial measures for that. Very much so. Remedial measures. Going to have to crack some heads of zone 4, you know, collective amphetamine psychosis folks. They're going to, you know, we're going to have to crack down on it. And we are doing it. And, you know, we have to crack down on it really hard. And they're going to have to learn some tough lessons, actually, at some point, really tough lessons. It may turn out that, you know, stuff may happen that our zone 5 coaches may pull the right certain strings, and they're going to say, what in the heck happened, you know? Didn't see that coming. Yeah, very, very much so. Very much so. So I don't know exactly what they're going to do, but they basically let me know that they're going to do what needs to be done to help us out, to make sure that we don't get pulled into that amphetamine psychosis tsunami that's very much on the way. Okay, so that's about it. The light's getting low, and I've got to get some dinner for someone, or else I'm going to get in trouble. Thanks so much for spending so much time watching this, and I know if you've put the time into this, the wheels are turning in you. You're saying, wow, very, very interesting. Very, very, more than interesting, very compelling and helpful. Okay, until next time. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.